there are private pension funds, and these are pools of money which are, have a long-term gestation period, pension funds, life insurance funds. And these funds have to find somewhere to invest their money. And so to de-risk their appetite and their portfolio, rather than put all their money in equities or the government bonds, they can put them also into infrastructure, as long as they're bankable, and they have positive cash flows, and they give a fairly good return above inflation rate. So long-term money has to find long-term assets. That's the answer to your question.
Right. But then we also understand that the intra-African trade, which we are speaking about here today at the Africa CEO Forum, but also a conversation that is happening around the continent, pretty much looking on infrastructure, both soft infrastructure, but also hard infrastructure, including airports, railways, road network, and all of that. Is the financing gap or the demand is way up north of $2 billion annually, according to the Africa Development Bank. Tell me, what needs to be done at this moment to ensure that this is on track?
Well, clearly, for the Continental Free Trade Agreement to work, and for intra-Africa trade to increase and blossom and be, you know, for the benefit of Africans, we have to find a way of also connecting African countries physically. It's not just about talk trade, but also the physical connections. Because if you want to trade amongst African countries, some countries are on the coast, many countries are landlocked. So the connection between, you know, countries on the coast and landlocked countries is land rail, or road, or by air, depending on which is the most cheapest and more efficient. So there has to be some investment in infrastructure to connect countries. I don't know if you remember at all, but in 2014, I think it was, at the WEF Africa held in Abuja,
right,
in Nigeria, the Chinese premier came with 200-man delegation. And he, in his speech, he said China's, you know, objective was to connect Africa by rail, which many people laughed about. But the honest truth is that if you look at what's happened to the railway line now between, for example, Mombasa and Nairobi, that's driven down the length of time and you spent getting to Nairobi. And then also from Djibouti to Addis, which is a 3-day journey, it's now 8 hours. And the plan is to move, take the railway line from Nairobi into both Uganda and Rwanda. Now these countries are landlocked, and the only way they can accelerate further development is to have access to the coast or access to markets. So there has to be a major plan to connect Africa by infrastructure. It's supposed to be the Trans-Africa Highway, which has been in the cards for 20, 30 years. Now, the way to make these projects bankable is for countries to remove the borders and say to ourselves, this is an infrastructure asset. Look at the traffic on the corridor. How can we get more traffic into that corridor? How can we make it much more attractive for investors to put money into? But, you know, infrastructure is not just about putting money here. It's also about managing the infrastructure,
right,
for the benefit of the consumer in a way that will generate positive cash flows and be efficient and be maintained. Because in many countries, you have infrastructure that decays after 10, 20 years. There's no maintenance, not done properly, and then the roads fall apart. So, you know, there's many aspects to making infrastructure work for the continent. And I think there are models. You can see what's happened in China, it's what's happened in Europe over the last 100 years, or Latin America, and put in place, you know, models for which we can finance infrastructure. And that financing doesn't have to be African money alone. It can be foreign money. It can be Chinese money. It can be European money. Whatever funding, you know, want to come into infrastructure,
right,
into a growing part of the world.
Right. Kunle, I just want to stay exactly right there on that particular conversation with financing. We've seen what happened with Sri Lanka, the port that China currently took over, right? And we've signed different loans with, of course, the Chinese government to finance the SGR, with the government of Kenya. And we've definitely been looking at this as a way to grow intra-regional trade, right? But, and creation of jobs. But the conversation moves beyond that and looks at, if in the colonial time the railways that were created were to move gold and diamond and all other resources out of Africa,
raw materials,
how do we know right now, how sure are we that this infrastructure that is being built on taxpayers' money is more in benefit for African traders than it is for the Chinese traders?
Very good question. But I think that's why, you know, when we go to negotiate some of these financing deals, we have to do so knowing that we have a plan.
Right.
And that we need the money to do a plan that will benefit us. If you don't do that, then clearly the financier, who has another objective, could then change the entire conversation and change the plan. But more importantly, up until now, I'm not aware that there's any kind of master plan for African infrastructure to facilitate trade. I haven't seen one or heard about one. So as we are talking about, once we hopefully get the 22nd country that signs and the free trade agreement becomes an agreement that we need to implement, there needs to be different work streams around, you know, travel permits across Africa, for example, you know, how do we deal with borders, you know, putting together a master plan for African infrastructure to facilitate trade, you know, the things around duties and customs unions, you know, movement of people. You know, it's almost like what the EU have done over the last 50, 60 years. So we're trying to do what they did in a shorter period of time, because there's an urgency on the continent of Africa to ensure that we can trade amongst ourselves to increase growth and have a faster rate of development across the continent. Because we need to have some sort of reasonably equitable development across the continent. Otherwise, you're going to have countries that are more developed,
right,
will attract migrants from countries that are less developed, and create a new kind of problem in those countries, like you see from Zimbabwe going across into South Africa, for example. You know, so we need to have a master plan that suits us, and then take away the borders, look at the asset. So if a railway line is going to cover three countries, and because the traffic is, will only happen if the three countries cooperate, then we should take away the borders,
right,
and let the railway line be built. But if we say, if the country in between says, no, I don't want the railway line to pass through that village or that town, then it makes the whole thing uneconomic, and the funding will not come.
Do we have the capacity to pay back these loans, or are we looking at debt trapping at this particular moment?
Well, the way I understand infrastructure works in any developing country or even developed market is that once you can put in place infrastructure that facilitates development, what happens? The economy grows faster, you create jobs. When you create jobs, you have many more taxpayers. When you have more tax revenue, the tax revenue becomes available to pay back the infrastructure. So what, unfortunately, when a leader builds an infrastructure from a capital to his village, and the only person traveling on that road is him and his family, that road is not going to be bankable. you get my point?
Right.
So you need to look at, you know, where are the farming communities? How can you move certain products, if it's for the coffee industry, or if it's for the cocoa industry, or if it's for the cotton industry? And we know there's a cluster of industries here, but we can move raw materials from that industry, that those farming settlements, to that industrial park in that country. And by doing so, we can create more jobs, we can produce goods and much more goods, which we can export back to another African country. Then it makes sense.